its exclusive zone in the Gulf of Mexico, it was a sovereign decision which nobody can impede. The adversaries of normalization and supporters of present policy argued that the U.S. government could not negotiate with Cuba the necessary cooperation that exists on the issue of oil drilling with other neighborly countries like Canada, Mexico, and Russia, much less an agreement to benefit from these findings. They have partly succeeded. The U.S. has accepted to participate only in multilateral cooperation talks with Cuba, not bilateral. On another case, the arrest and conviction in Havana of Alan Gross, an American citizen hired by the U.S. Agency for International Development through a third party to bring into Cuba communications equipment, an activity clearly considered illegal by Cuban law, has become a major disputing point. The Cuban government has clearly stated that it is ready to consider the issue in government-to-government negotiations. The U.S. State Department has refused even to talk to the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in Havana to discuss the subject, probably because it knows that the Cuban side has a similar request related to its five citizens arrested and convicted in the United States for carrying out surveillance of terrorist cells in Miami. The same year these Cuban agents were arrested, a series of bombs exploded in Havana hotels and restaurants, one of them killing a young Italian tourist. This is an issue, the liberation of Alan Gross and the Cuban Five, which requires urgent government-to-government negotiations for humanitarian reasons. Havana wants to talk about it. Washington does not. Whatever these men have done, they have already paid, and the suffering of their families should be stopped. It can be argued by both sides that the six of them were doing their duty as they interpreted it. You cannot try and convict governments. My final comments have to do with the change that is taking place in Cuba. Since Raul Castro launched his updating of the economic model, Cuba has entered a new stage in its search for a future of dignity and prosperity for all Cubans. The challenges that the Cuban leadership faces are huge. They do not have much time. At times, it seems that the government is not doing enough. A similar situation happens in the United States with the change promised by President Obama. I was reading recently a book by Michael Grunwald titled A New New Deal, The Hidden Story of Change in the Obama Era. It reminded me very much of what is happening in Cuba. Sometimes when we are in the middle of the changes, we don't see them. We have to take a step backwards and look at the big picture. The big picture in Cuba can be summarized as follows. The updating of the Cuban economic model is much more than that. It is a profound reform of Cuban economics and politics. It is gradual but relentless. At times it seems very slow, but one can understand the argument that things have to be thought out well. There is no room for mistakes. Change is going on in basically in two directions. The first and most important is making the Cuban economy more efficient in order to sustain its independence and its social achievements. To do that, in the world of today, you have to broaden the space for market forces to operate, as the Chinese and Vietnamese governments have done. This is what Cuba is doing. It is calculated that in a few years, 45% of Cuba's labor force will be in the non-state or private sector. That means small and medium-sized enterprises, cooperatives, self-employment. The second one is political and means the democratization of the system and the opening up of public spaces for deliberation. Several public intellectuals, like Rafael and me, are involved in this difficult process. It's not easy, no es fácil, as Cubans usually say. But we are confident that the Cuba that will emerge will be more democratic, more decentralized, more autonomous, and more just. Hopefully, it will also be more prosperous without giving up its stability. In the framework of the changes taking place, the government released a large number of political prisoners. What does this mean to the future of Cuban-U.S. relations? It means that there will be more spaces for cooperation and dialogue, that the United States should not continue to be on the sidelines or working against change as it does today. It can be a player, but it has to change its policy towards Cuba and treat its government, its people, its society with respect. As a Cuban who respects whatever is positive in the U.S., but does not want to return to the situation of subordination we had before 1959, I look forward to the normalization of relations, which will not mean an absence of conflict. In order to achieve this, we have to do what is most difficult, change the mentality. The narratives of our relations, part of it based on cold facts, need to be overhauled and confidence building must take place. This can only happen if our societies become more open towards each other on the basis of mutual respect to what we have achieved. That's what I'm betting on. That's what I'm working on. Thank you.